Connie Mack considered him his best big game pitcher. Mack is reported to have said, "If everything depends on one game, I just used Albert, the greatest money pitcher of all time." Mack was referring to Charles Albert Bender, the Hall of Fame pitcher who played for the Athletics from 1903 through 1914. Bender, whose father was a German-American homesteader who settled in Minnesota and whose mother was part Chippewa, was a member of the Ojibwe tribe in Minnesota. Bender and his family were farmers on the White Earth Indian Reservation in Minnesota, and he was given the name Mandawasin in Ojibwe, meaning little spirit animal. Because of his Native American heritage, Bender was given the nickname Chief, and to this day, almost every fan of baseball history knows the name Chief Bender, but few can easily recall that his given name is Charles Albert. Nonetheless, even as a Native American, he was honored with his induction into the National Baseball Hall of Fame. And while Charles Albert Chief Bender most certainly had to endure taunting and discrimination because of his race, he wasn't excluded from the major leagues the way African Americans were.
Welcome to Philadelphia Baseball History.
Don't forget to check out our merchandise. T-shirts, phone cases, masks, notebooks, mugs, and much more. Just go to tpublic.com and look for Philadelphia Baseball History. It's a very odd dichotomy in baseball history. Certainly American oppression against Native Americans is undeniable. Caucasian Americans forced Native Americans off their lands. America waged war against Native Americans to drive westward and to make it safe for new settlers and homesteaders. Discrimination against Native Americans was persistent and rampant. Yet Albert Bender was not the first Native American to play Major League Baseball. Most believe that William Sockalexis was the first Native American to play in the major leagues. Sockalexis was from the Penobscot tribe in Maine. A Catholic, he attended Holy Cross College and then Notre Dame, where Sockalexis played baseball for the school's team. Sockalexis was so talented that he caught the eye of baseball scouts while Notre Dame played exhibition games against major league teams. In 1897, Sockalexis signed a contract to play with the Cleveland Spiders of the National League. When Sockalexis began playing for Cleveland, there was a color ban in Major League Baseball. There had been two African-American players who played in the major leagues in the 19th century, Fleetwood Moses Walker and his brother, Weldy Wilberforce Walker, played for the Toledo Blue Stockings, who joined the American Association in 1884. Today, Major League Baseball officially recognizes the American Association as a major league. Indeed, four National League franchises got their start as American Association teams. But in 1883, when Toledo played the Chicago White Stockings in an exhibition game, Chicago's manager, Cap Anson, a Philadelphia native, objected, using some very harsh language to describe Fleet Walker. Toledo's manager, Charles Morton, reminded Anson of the consequences of forfeiting the game and thus the gate receipts. Then he made sure to start Walker in right field. Anson reluctantly played the game, but ensured that in all future exhibition game contracts, there was a clause prohibiting African American players. By 1885, largely due to Anson's insistence, both major leagues, the National League and the American Association, imposed a ban on African American players. But 12 years later, a Native American player was welcomed by Cleveland's National League club with much anticipation. In fact, sports writers began calling the Cleveland Spiders Thibault's Indians, a reference not only to Sockalexis, but also to Cleveland manager Patsy Thibault. Now, was that moniker to honor Sockalexis? Well, that's debatable, considering Sockalexis had to face extreme bigotry and discrimination in his time in the major leagues. In intra-squad scrimmages, for example, Tebow would divide his team in two, and he would call one side the Indians while calling the other the Papooses. This can hardly be seen as a sign of respect. When Cleveland played the Giants in the Polo Grounds, Sockalexis had to endure racist epithets and chanting by the New York crowd. It's hardly surprising that, placed under such pressure, Sockalexis had his career cut short because he turned to the bottle for comfort. Nonetheless, the point remains that while African Americans were excluded from Major League Baseball, Native Americans were not. In fact, posing as a Native American was seen as a possible way for one light-complexioned African American player to break through to the majors. And I'm talking about Charlie Grant. Charlie Grant was a talented second baseman who had made a name for himself playing for various African American teams in the late 19th century. During that time, African Americans could make money playing baseball professionally by barnstorming or traveling from town to town playing exhibition games against the town's local team. It was also known for hotels to employ athletically talented African Americans as bellhops, for example, and to have the men also form a baseball team that could play for the entertainment of the hotel guests. In 1901, Charlie Grant was working for a bellhop for the Eastman Hotel in Hot Springs, Arkansas. That is where the American League's Baltimore Orioles were conducting their spring training. The manager of the Orioles, one John McGraw, caught a few games of the hotel staff and noticed that Grant had major league talent. He wanted Grant to play for the Orioles and devised a way to try to get around the color barrier. You see, Grant's complexion was light and his hair was straight. McGraw thought that Grant could pass as a Native American as opposed to an African American. After noticing the name Tokahama as the name of a creek on a map that he saw at the Eastman Hotel, McGraw began calling Grant Charlie Tokahama and claiming that he was a member of the Cherokee tribe. McGraw was prepared to start Grant, or Tokahama, in his season opener against the new American League Chicago White Sox, not to be confused with the White Stockings, who became the Chicago Cubs. But the White Sox owner, Charles Comiskey, objected, as Comiskey had seen Grant play when one of his earlier teams had visited Chicago in another season. For a while, McGrath continued with the ruse, but eventually gave in and dropped Grant from his opening day lineup. Grant would go on to be the star second baseman for Saul White's Philadelphia Giants, who claimed the title of World's Colored Champions from 1904 through 1906. But the treatment of African American players by Major League Baseball remains a stain on the otherwise proud history of the sport. Although Native Americans and Hispanics certainly endured bigotry and discrimination, they were not excluded from the major leagues the way African Americans were. And this is what makes Jackie Robinson's breaking of the color barrier in 1947 such a significant event in baseball, indeed American, history. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed that video. If you did, please hit the like button. Please hit subscribe so you won't miss another video as we publish them. And don't forget to hit the bell icon so you get notification when we do publish those videos. Tell your friends about us. In the description box, you'll see a link to our merch store. You will also find instructions on how you can help support this channel and help us to continue to make videos like this.